Pearson's coefficient of skewness is a very simple way to begin to measure the skewness in a distribution. Before we get into specifically how Pearson's coefficient of skewness is calculated, we got to briefly touch on skewness in general. When we look at skewness, when we think about skewness, we have different conditions that can exist. We can have a distribution that is what we would consider negatively skewed. Of course, we can have distributions that are symmetrical, right? And then we can have distributions that are positively skewed. Now, in these cases where we have this skewness, our mean and our median don't line up. So if you imagine our mathematical center as defined by the mean is over here, and our median is kind of shifted over. All right, the exact opposite is true when we look at a positive distribution. Again, we have our mean out in this direction, and our median somewhere in here, right? The mode comes into play somewhere in here, but honestly, who cares much about the mode? It doesn't do a lot for us, at least in a business context. All right, and of course, when we have a symmetrical distribution, this mathematical center of the data is statistically equal to our natural center of the data as defined by the median. So there are a lot of different ways to calculate skewness. There's some that are far more complicated, in this case, accurate. But one of the things I like with, in particular, BA254 at this early stage, is when we're starting to talk about a concept like skewness, it's nice to put a number to it. And one of the really nice ways to do that is we can look at Pearson's coefficient of skewness. All right. So Pearson's coefficient of skewness is massively simple. And the other reason I like this is you're going to see what Pearson's coefficient of skewness does is it leverages data or specific measures that we've already been using. So the X bar in this introductory descriptive section, we've obviously been spending a lot of time with. The median, all right, is also a value that we've been studying. And then, of course, our standard deviation. So it's kind of a nice review problem for some of the different variables that we've been calculating within our beginning stages of our semester, and especially in this descriptive statistics side, descriptive statistics section. I'm going to look at a white paper that we have for 254. Specifically, I'm looking at white paper 2.5. I'm just going to read it off to you. And it says, a small sample of students in BA 254 were asked how many hours of sleep they got the night before. The results were as follows. Marley got 4 hours. Edward got 8 hours. So actually, I'll just write this off to the side. Marley got 4 hours. Edward got 8 hours. Maxwell, or Max, got 6 hours. Spencer got 8 hours. And Nina got 9 hours. So this is my set of data. I'm not going to walk us all the way back through it, but I'm going to summarize this and say, the X bar for this set of data ends up being 7. Our median for this set of data ends up being 8. And our standard deviation is 2. Okay? So we're familiar with how to go in and calculate each one of these measures. You can certainly do that for this set of data over here. If I plug those values into my skewness calculation, I end up with 3 times the X bar was 7 minus my median of 8 divided by 2 tells me that Pearson's coefficient of skewness ends up being -1.50. Now, one thing to point out with Pearson, Pearson's coefficient of skewness can only exist in an interval from -3 up to +3. A value close to or at 0 means that it's symmetrical. If you get anything above 3, +3 or -3, you've done something wrong. All right, we just mathematically with Pearson cannot exceed those ends of the interval. Now, because we're early in the semester and because Pearson is a very simplistic measure, the only thing that we could do is take and evaluate, for example, this value, this -1.5, and say, where does it fit in our scale? So if we're here at -1.50, we can't make a lot of statements about this, but we could certainly say, given Pearson's coefficient of skewness, we see some measure, some I would contend fairly strong measure of a negative skewness within the set of data, understanding it's a simplistic measure and it's a very, very small set of data. All right. We will be moving on after we go through a section on probability and another a number of other areas. We will be moving into spending a lot of time here where we're dealing with symmetrical normal distributions. But then as we move through the semester, we'll start to spend especially time up here and with some distributions that are positively skewed. That'll be coming later. We also along the way then can start to do some hypothesis tests to prove poor choice of words on my part, but to find out whether or not our assumptions about the shape of these distributions is valid or reasonable. But that is a really quick look at skewness. One of the nice measures when we look at this in the early stages is this Pearson's coefficient. You'll see other measures, but this one really does a nice job of, again, of highlighting kind of the relative position of some of these variables that we've been calculating and are growing more and more familiar with.